the theme that we were doing for the men's retreat. We're going to continue this morning, and so for those of you who were not at the men's retreat, either you were not qualified because you were not a man, or you had other things to do that prevented you from coming, we're sorry that you weren't there, but I want to catch you up for just a moment. The theme has been worlds colliding, and it's an examination of our worldview. A worldview is simply the framework upon which or through which we view the world, through which we interpret the things of the world around us. There are those who start with the fundamental assumption that there is no God. As a result, as they start looking at the facts of the universe, they look at the environment around them and all the things that they see, and they interpret those things based upon the assumption that there is no God. For example, as scientists begin looking at fossils or data evidence of some sort, they take half of the options which would contribute to the existence of God, and they throw those away and close their mind and only open them to the things that they can explain in a naturalistic way. Nature itself has brought these products into existence, and no power outside of nature. Then there's another philosophy of the world, a worldview that says there is a God. That if we were to put all of the universe inside of a box, with all of its natural laws and universal forces, that outside of that box there would exist a force that is above or supernatural. We would say that that is, of course, the God of the Bible. Those are the two extremes that stand at one pole or the other pole. But what we've seen is through the ages, those who are theistic believers, those who assume that there is a God, and I'm not saying that God is only assumption, but only in for reference or purposes of these lessons, those that start with a framework that says there is a God have been led to believe that there are certain things in this life that we have to accept from the humanist or atheistic point of view as well. And so they try to mix these two poles and stand somewhere in between them. We're not completely here or completely there. In fact, we're told that to be enlightened, to be informed, is not to be an extreme theist. You don't have to be an atheist, just don't be an extreme theist. We are mixing God and deluding Him with things of the world. And I'm reminded very quickly of Elijah when he said, "How long are you going to go limping between these two ways? If the Lord is God, serve Him. But if Baal be God, then serve him." Elijah says they are at two opposite extremes. They are the poles. He says you can't bring a little Baal and a little God to the middle and say, "I'll stand here." He said, "You're just limping between these two. Make a choice." Or Joshua, toward the end of his life, "If it seems evil for you this day to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served across the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now dwell, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." You see, there's always that choice. And so those choices, when we try to bring them together, it causes really the worlds to collide. If you have your Bibles this morning, be turning to Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. When we were at the retreat center, my brother was able to come. Came down from Oklahoma City and joined us. And after the retreat was over, he and I went to our old home place. We grew up about 25 miles east of where the retreat center was this past weekend. So we went back home, as it were, and jumped the fence because we didn't have a key to the gate. We still own the property. We just don't have a key to it. We jumped the gate and we went down and we were walking around the old home place, and the, that you know through the history, the house that is sitting there. We built a log cabin in the woods. You know, it was kind of my mom and dad's dream, build a log cabin in the woods. And so they found a place and built a log cabin. And I remember years ago when I was late elementary, fourth, fifth, maybe sixth grade. My brother's two grades ahead of me, so he's probably sixth, seventh, or eighth, or something like that. And it was time to start digging a foundation. And I don't know how your fifth and sixth graders are here, but my parents gave my brother and I a shovel and a pickaxe and an actual double-headed axe and said, dig a straight line from here to there. And we actually dug the foundation for our house by hand. It was my dad, my brother, and me. We had to dig a footing as first, which was about, well, it had to be 2 inches or 2 feet wide, and then it was the size of the house, which I believe was 24 by 40 or so. And the ground gently sloped this way, so down on this end was easy. We had to dig down about 4 foot, 4.5 foot, but on the other end, I remember where the high side of the dirt was. We were, the dirt was higher than our heads, and we were down in those trenches digging. And when we'd come across the tree roots, we'd have to get the axe out and chop it down. But that's what you did when you wanted to build a secure house. And I remember the day that the cement truck came out and filled it with concrete. So it was a solid wall, rectangle wall inside the ground. And then Dad built the footing on top of that, and they built the house. We went back and saw that house. And it was kind of touching to think that foundation, well, let me tell you one other thing. That house that we built actually burned. After we'd lived in it several years and I got married and moved away, that house burned to the ground. And Mom and Dad started rebuilding the house from the same foundation. That's actually the house that we went and saw. The house that was a new house, but it was on the old foundation. That's how important foundations are. At the end of his great Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gives us the picture of the wise man and the foolish man. Remember the song, "The wise man built his house upon the rock." Right? And the rains came tumbling down. And he's differentiating between those who will hear the words and do them and those who hear the words and do not do them. And it's reminiscent of James chapter 1 and verse 22. I remember as a late teenager, the man that eventually converted me was studying with me, and he would say all the time, "Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves." If you think that you've done all that you are supposed to do, be a doer of the word. It's not enough to simply read John 3:16 over and over, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." We look at that verse and we find great comfort in it, but he would always say to me, it's not just about reading those words, you actually have to do something. You have to believe, you have to live in a way that pleases God. You approach him for the salvation that you desire and that you want. Don't just read the words, don't just be a hearer of the words, be a doer also. In Revelation 1 and verse 3, "Blessed is he that reads the words of this book and does them." Over and over and over we're told to go beyond merely listening. Go beyond just hearing or reading or seeing the words. Go all the way to the point of obedience. And so we come to what's often referred to as Jesus' Sermon on the Plain. This is not the same as the Sermon on the Mount. Most likely it's another episode of Jesus teaching very much the same words of the lesson of the Sermon on the Mount. But in this particular case, he continues that theme that he began early in his ministry of what it means to live as people of the kingdom. We're of the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God on earth, right? We understand that this is the kingdom. The church is his kingdom. And we live in this world that all around us is fallen and decaying. We see it first in the spiritual sense because we see the moral corruption. But look, when Adam and Eve partook of the fruit that was forbidden to them, it says that they died. You think about how people die today. They get old and their bodies wear out. They get struck by natural disasters. They get hit by diseases that take their life away from them. Accidents, murders, violence of some sort. That's how people die today. So when he said that if you eat of that fruit, you shall surely die, immediately the world became a hostile place. In order for that promise to come to fruition, man was going to have to start to age. Disease was introduced into the world. Natural disasters would come. Violence was allowed by other humans. The world's a hostile place. And against the backdrop of this fallen world, we have the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God that says, yes, my body may be aging and wearing out, but I still find glory in God. Yes, I may see violence and hatred in this world, and I may even be tempted to engage in those things, but I've got to live for Christ in this world and show that there's a way of peace and compassion and love. That's kingdom living. Isn't that what he deals with in the Sermon on the Mount? Kingdom living, this great kingdom living. And he gets down to the end and says, all of these things that I've described for you, for example, in the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Those promises, those words, he comes down to the end of that sermon and he says, now all these things that I've been telling you, let's do them. Put them into practice. The one that hears these words of mine and does them, I'll show you what he is like. I want to use the passage from Luke, though, in Luke chapter 6, beginning about verse 46, where he tells the same story of the wise man and the foolish man in the hearing, but there's a key difference to me in Luke's account that I think is important for us to focus upon. But the idea of what we're doing this morning is we're digging to the rock. And this particular passage has that one phrase that he dug down to the rock. And we're going to look and see what that means. But let's look beginning in verse 46. He says, why do you call me Lord and not do what I tell you? So instantly we're introduced to the idea that calling Jesus Lord involves action. More than just lip service to God, it requires us to do something. It is impossible to say I am a follower of Christ and not follow Christ. That's essentially what Jesus is saying. Why do you call me Lord? Why would you set me up and say that I follow Jesus as my Lord and then not do the things that I tell you to do? Why would you say you are a follower if you're not going to follow? To him, it was foolishness. It was the height of contradiction in this life. And so he says, everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show you what he is like. So he's going to paint for us a picture. And it is a picture for those who come to Jesus and they listen to the words that he has to say and then puts them into practice. I think sometimes the church has a disconnect here. We come and we hear these words. We listen to Corey or the elders or other ministers here that are preaching and teaching and disseminating the Word of God and its purity and in a great way. We listen to those, and then somehow that translation from hearing it in the pew to living it when I walk out the doors becomes difficult. I understand that. I know that it's hard. If it were easy, we would accidentally be Christians, but you can't accidentally be Christian. Christianity is a choice you make. All of us, each one of us, has to make that choice of Christianity and determine that I'm going to live that way. If it were easy, everyone would be doing it, but they're not. What's he like? He says, he is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And so instantly we see the idea of digging all the way down to the foundation, to the bedrock. We understand the ideas of rocks from the Old Testament. They've been prophesying that there was going to come a rock which the builders were going to reject. That was going to be the chief cornerstone of this new kingdom of God. In Acts chapter 4, it tells us that that rock which the builders rejected was Jesus Christ himself. When Jesus with his disciples are going towards Caesarea Philippi, and the largest mountain in the region, Mount Hermon, is starting to loom in their sight, and the rock walking towards it, and he said, well, who do the people say that I am? And Peter, you'll recall, says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Well, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonas, for flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father who is in heaven. That's who's revealed it to you. And upon this rock I will build my church. Matthew 16. Upon the rock of this great confession that I am, in fact, the Son of God. That's that rock, and I'm going to build my church. My eternal, everlasting building will be on that rock. The gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it. I build my house. In Ephesians 2, he refers to the rock as the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. We understand the concept of rocks, of bedrock, of the stability that it offers, that it is solid, it is load-bearing, it has the ability to hold up whatever God is able to put upon it. And so the picture of a man building a house and building upon the rocks is a wonderful scene. It's one that we understand, we identify quickly with it. We go to areas where they're building new homes and they're scraping off dirt, and the first thing put down is that slab, that concrete slab, that man-made rock in this case, to build the structure upon. Years ago, I was in Honduras. I was out in one of the poor areas of town. They had their homes were pieces of tin. There was no framework, it seemed like. They were wired together with baling wire at the corner, and I remember standing at the doorway of one of them, and there was a lady sweeping a dirt floor. Isn't that odd? Seems like you would never be finished if you're sweeping a dirt floor. Of course, they walk on it, and it makes it very packed, and so she's just sweeping off the very top loose part. But when the storms hit, the winds blew, no amount of baling wire held those homes together. It just wasn't strong enough. And there was no foundation to hold them up. He is like the strong man. The flood rose against that house, this one built upon the rock. The stream broke against it, the house, but it could not shake it. The torrents are flowing. Back in the Middle East during the time, that they had these little tributaries that would run into the Jordan River. They were referred to as wadis. And during the dry months of the year, if you were on a trek and you were walking along the Jordan River, well, it was, you know, very, very low at that time, and you would come across one of these wadis, and you might have to take a couple of fast steps and leap across. It wasn't any big deal. During the rainy months, when the rains came, those wadis would swell. The banks, or the Jordan, would rise out of its banks and go into the lands and fill all the... You couldn't just simply hop across one of them. Those are the torrents that are coming down, and they're beating on the sides of this house as the water is rushing by. And the house is able to stay right there. It's able to stand firm. In fact, it uses a word, it could not shake it. I like that phrase. It's used in Hebrews chapter 12 at the end of the chapter when it says, seeing we've received this kingdom that cannot be shaken. This church cannot be shaken. Though the devil and the world beat against this church, it will not fall because it cannot be shaken. When everything else in the world is crumbling, when the elements are being burned up, this church will not be shaken because its foundation is not on this earth. Its foundation is in heaven. And so this is the same phrase. This torrent of life that is beating against this house, it can't shake it because it has been well built. But the one who hears, Jesus says, and does not do them is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. And I look at this, I think of this, you read the Matthew account and there's this picture of the wise man looks around and he sees the rock and he goes over and he says, this would be a great place to build my house. And so he builds his house on the rock. And it's not as if the foolish man looks around and says, I don't want a rock, I want a good sandy place to put my house. I think the foolish man, he's standing here and he looks down and he says, this looks like a good place to build a house. He's too lazy to go and find the rock. He's too lazy to do anything. So he builds exactly where he's standing, which he happens to be standing on sandy ground. No man in his right mind, if he's looking for the best place to build a house, is going to reason the sandy soil is the best soil. It's not there because he reasoned. It's there because he's too lazy to reason about it. So he built it on the ground without a foundation. And when the stream broke against it, immediately it fell. And the ruin of that house was great. We understand these depictions. The idea, that the house that we're building is the life that we have. It's what we have right here on this earth, how we live, how we react toward God and His call toward us. But at the same time, the foundation. I know, for example, in Matthew 16, we mentioned earlier, the confession of Christ became the foundation of the church. The apostles and the prophets in Ephesians 2 are looked upon as the foundation. So when we come to these places, we have to look what the context says of the foundation. In this case, the foundation is doing the word. That's the only difference. They are both hearing the word. The wise man does it, builds a foundation, or has a foundation. And the foolish man doesn't do it. He has no foundation. So it's obedience to God that becomes either the foundation or the lack thereof. But we look at the stream. The stream is the word. It's the trials and the tribulations. It's the natural disasters. It's the disease. It's the fear that this world brings. It's the taunting and the mocking that those who are outside of Christ look at those who are in a life with a foundation because they have built upon the rock of obedience. And they mock and they ridicule and they tear you down. Those are the torrents of life. Those are the streams that are beating against the house. So what's the dirt? When it says that the wise man dug deep. See, Matthew doesn't have that phrase. So it's not just a matter of the wise man is looking around and finding a rock and says, oh, that's a good rock, I'll build my house on it. It's the wise man went to work. He knew that underneath the ground, underneath this dirt, there was rock. And he knew that rock would hold his house. When I first started preaching, I was living in preaching in a town called Granite, Oklahoma. Granite, Oklahoma. Just like the rock. In fact, the whole area, it was just a series of granite rocks. There were 5 granite quarries that would mine the granite out of the rock and would sell it for tombstones and landmarks and things like that. And there were 2 cemeteries. One of them was outside of town and kind of in a lowland area. And there was a prison there, and the prison waters all drained off into this low area. I always heard people say, and I wasn't there long enough to tell you this, but they'd always say, that ground was sour. I don't think it was because it was a prison, it was because what was coming out of the prison, the runoff out of the prison, not the people, the actual runoff out of the prison, soured the ground. No one wanted to be buried there. So they had another cemetery, they called it Rock Hill Cemetery in Granite, Oklahoma. And so gravediggers there got paid really well. And they may have had one of the funnest jobs, because gravediggers at Rock Hill Cemetery simply scraped off the 6 inches of topsoil and drilled into the solid rock and would set dynamite and blow rock out of the ground in order to bury people. Can you imagine, every time you would go to dig a grave, it took dynamite. You know, it's fun enough to get to do it with a track hoe or a backhoe, but man, imagine getting to use dynamite to blow holes in the ground. I always thought that'd be a nice job, but that's kind of what's happening here. There's some topsoil, but there's rock down there, and that rock is strong enough to hold up this man's house. When I read this, I see this dirt as being all the refuse and the rubbish, all the things that the world puts out there to distract us from God, to make us miss seeing God. It's the philosophies of the world that challenge us. And so I'm going to go through just a couple of philosophies, introduce them here, and then in our worship period, we're actually going to look at and see how those affect our families. You know, we sometimes think of philosophy as something that's far off and doesn't have anything really to do with us, but it does influence us, and so we're going to talk about them. But the first one is the idea of secularism. Secularism lives for the here and now. It's actually, secular is from a Latin word, seculum, which means the now, the seculum mundus, the here and the now. All we have is what we see. All we can do is what we do right here. This is it. It doesn't affect anything into eternity, because there's nothing in eternity. They deny the very existence of anything beyond this universe. That means secularism denies God. We hear today in news reports, they talk about Islamic countries and certain ones that are secular Islam and certain ones that are Orthodox Islam. They use that term secular. What that means is that they are secular-minded. They're not concerned about the hereafter. They're only concerned about the right now and what they can get for now. There's another doctrine that's referred to as humanism. It puts its emphasis on what? Humans, humanity. Humanists hold that man is the pinnacle of evolution. We have worked our way up to the top of the food chain, as it were, so far. In the humanist mind, evolution is continuing, and so we may evolve into something greater than humanity, but up to right now, humanity is the highest. Life is anthropocentric, which means that it revolves around man. It doesn't revolve around the animals, it doesn't revolve around God, it revolves around man. And everything that we do is going to impact us as a human race. It focuses on the needs and the desires of man. What we're going to get here. There's another one that's important to us. Materialism. Back when I was a teenager, Madonna was the material girl. Maybe some of you remember that. Materialism believes that matter. Yeah, you get into the sciencey stuff here. You know, matter is the substance made up of the elements of the periodic table of elements. Remember, that's matter. Anything from gold to silver to iron, those are the elements. And so they make up the matter of this universe. Materials believe that matter or that material is supreme, that it is the God. What we can get our hands on here, that's what matters. You've seen the old cartoon he who dies with the most toys wins. That's materialism. That's recognizing or saying that the things of this earth, the matter that we can get our hands on, that's what counts. This leads, of course, to the accumulation of material as a means for salvation. She really wasn't buying a stairway to heaven. She was sure trying. Relativism. Relativism believes that a situation dictates necessary action. One of my children's favorite movies when they were young was the movie Aladdin. Walt Disney's Aladdin. Maybe you remember that. And there's a scene at the beginning of the movie where we're getting to know Aladdin, and he's running through the streets of the city there, and he's stealing bread and apples and all the things, and you know he makes the I steal only what I can't afford is a line in the song. Would you steal bread to feed your starving family? You know, those old philosophical debates. What they're trying to say is that just, you know, in one instance where it may be wrong to steal bread, but if your family is starving, then it's okay to steal the bread. And so it becomes relative to the situation that you're in. You can't make a hard and fast rule like it's always wrong to steal. You couldn't do that. That's relativism. They reject the notion of truth or absolute truth and say that knowledge is relative, it is limited, and it is biased. That's relativism. We have to be aware that it exists and that we are living in a time where people are saying it's all relative. Is that a warning bell or is that the last bell? 5 minutes. All right. Good, because I think I'm maybe on the last one here. Pluralism. If everything is relative, there is no absolute truth, then what happens is each one of us decides what is right for me. And if I've decided it's right for me, who are you to say that it's wrong? Now, I'm not going to say that what's right for me is necessarily right for you. You have your own choices to make. But your choices are just as valid as my choices. So what happens is we're not saying there's one absolute truth. We're saying there is a plurality of truth. So pluralists teach that every thought, philosophy, or belief is of equal value. No belief can be called morally superior to another. Jesus, calling for peace, love your enemies, is not morally superior than the prophet Muhammad, calling for his followers to kill everyone that does not believe. They're both right. There's enough room in this world for both philosophies because there are plural ways to be right, a plurality of ways. And all this leads to, here's my last one, all this leads to the philosophy of nihilism. We talked about this a little bit yesterday at the retreat. Nihilism is that sense of hopelessness. It's a godless worldview that results in nihilism because God created us with a spiritual need to seek Him. I think we have within us an innate need to seek something outside ourselves, something bigger than ourselves. And we try to fulfill that need in a lot of ways. Those who have a biblical worldview feel that need by looking to God. But there's a lot of other ways that people who don't believe in God, you know, there's no God, there's nothing beyond us. Well, how do you feel that need to have something bigger than yourself? Well, my fraternal organizations fulfill that need of something bigger than myself. Or the charities that I work and volunteer for, that's bigger than me. That fills that niche. But it doesn't. And denying that need really results in great despair. That's, you know, it is said that if you take a frog and toss him into hot water, that he will immediately jump out. That he won't stay in the hot water because it's instant. But if you put a frog in cool water and you begin to simply increase the heat a little bit at a time, that the frog will actually acclimate to the water as it's rising up. And before he recognizes what kind of predicament he is in, it is too late for him and he will already have been boiled. In our postmodern atheistic culture, they are constantly, it seems, turning up the heat on Christianity, constantly seeking ways to influence our worldview and change our primary understanding of the world. And it is very slow and it is very incremental. And many of us are finding ourselves waking up to having already been cooked. In this concluding lesson of the worlds colliding,
these lessons on worldview, I want to look at how these atheistic philosophies, if you were here in the Bible class hour, we gave a short introduction to several of them. We're going to see how those worldviews and philosophies are infiltrating our American culture, even the global culture, and it is changing us. It has touched every influence or every sphere of our lives, from our families to our economy to our policies to our theology. Everything is being changed before our very eyes. So far in this series on the worldview, accumulating with the retreat weekend as well as this morning, we have examined what a worldview is and how everything we do is it passes through this perceptual filter of our worldview. And there's a need for us as Christians to make sure that our worldview matches the Bible. That is, that the core of who we are at our very being, as Paul would say in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, that we are presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice. We're changing our behavior to match the behavior of heaven. We are changing what is good and acceptable, and we are being transformed by the renewing of our mind. We're changing that core person of who we are. Let's be honest, when left to ourselves and doing it the way we want to do it and what makes us feel right or what we think is right, we have messed up. That's why we come to Christ in submission and give Him our broken life. We give it to Him so that He can change us, not from the outside in, not from our behavior, hoping that will eventually influence our hearts, but He is changing our hearts that will then permeate every layer all the way to the behaviors that we have in this world. This morning in Bible class, we were looking at Luke 6 when He says that we're going to dig deep to the rock and build our house on a foundation of security. And what we're taking away from that foundation, what we're taking away to get to the rock, is the dirt of life. It's our long-held habits, our beliefs, and our long-practiced habits. It's the philosophy of the world. It's the distraction when the world is saying, over here, look at me. We're scraping that away. We're digging deep to the bedrock of God's foundation. But in order to really scrape that away, we have to understand what that is and how it's influenced. It's easy to sit here and say, well, nihilism is that philosophy of utter hopelessness. Or to say that materialism is the doctrine which seeks to gain wealth and accumulate wealth and die with the most toys so that you can win. But we see those kind of on the outside. That's what others do. That's what's in the world. That doesn't really affect us as the church. But what I want to show is that it does affect us. It's changing the church and the way the church behaves toward God. We've examined the two extremes, theism and atheism. Supernaturalism and naturalism, we've seen how they clash with one another. And Paul calls us to seek the things that are above, not the things that are of the earth, not the natural things. So this morning, I want to look at some of the more relevant or prevalent worldviews that are influencing us and threatening our society. And the first one is how these worldviews influence our families. We love our families. I think most of us look at them as one of the greatest things that we've ever accomplished on this earth. I look out here and I see moms and dads, grandmothers and grandfathers, brothers and sisters. Just to spend time with one another is a great blessing. It is our family. In the scripture reading this morning from Deuteronomy 6, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord, He is one. The Lord is unified. And those who are in Him are going to be unified in the same way." But how do we get there? "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as signs on your hands. They shall be as a frontlet before your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts and of your house and on your gates." We are supposed to saturate our lives in the Word of God, so that we can connect our family into the unity of God. That family that prays together stays together. The family that studies together will stay together. We draw closer and fall deeper into a love of God when we as a family work together. Fathers are not to provoke their children unto wrath, but Ephesians 6:4 says that we bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord, or some translations, in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. And yet we live in a world that is becoming more and more hostile toward the concept of family. In 2005, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled that parents do not have a constitutional right to be the exclusive provider of information regarding sexual matters to their children. Let's translate for that just for a moment. As parents, you are not the only one that has a right to teach your children. Well, who's going to come in and teach my children besides me? Well, the state will come in and we'll teach them things. Because you might teach them such things as abstinence. You might teach them things about God and things about Jesus. We will come in and give the other side of that educational coin. We'll teach them the things that you won't teach them. There was a time that we as parents thought we had the constitutional right to raise our children. But in our society, they're saying, no. No, you don't have a constitutional right to raise your own children. We will step in and help. We've heard of that before. We've heard of that in Marxist, socialist, communist countries. But in America, where freedom and liberty are to dictate the day, that seems foreign to us, and yet the leaders of our own country are already setting the stage for a coup against parents and their children. The Bible, as well as mountains and mountains of social research, say that children being raised by their biological parents, their born mother and born father, biological parents, gives a greater chance for societal success. Everything tells us this. Spend time with school administrators. Ask them who their star students are. Most of them are the ones that have the same father and mother they were born to. The vast majority do. Go to prisons and ask what their family structures are like, and you will find that the vast majority of them lack those two things. So we think of this idea that he's given to us. If it is true that it's best to be with biological parents, why is it that less than 25% of children raised in the United States of America are with their biological parents? Things happen. This is partly due to death, accidents that happen in the home, and all of a sudden a biological parent is taken away from a child. But that is a small fraction of the reason some people do not grow up with their biological parents. I think part of it is due to a lackadaisical attitude toward divorce, the postmodern mantra that the nuclear family is not important. Hollywood is constantly telling us there is a new definition of family. It was scandals years ago when on the Jeffersons, the neighbors were a black and white mixed race couple. People, oh, that's bad. God didn't care. But they really thought that they were changing the definition of family there. And then they took that small incremental step and they started going even further. And they started actually changing what God has given to us. Things like single parenthood being celebrated. I know there's things that happen and people end up as a single parent. That's not God's ideal. God's ideal was a man leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife. It's what the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24, that we are to leave the father and mother and hold fast to his wife, cleave, weld himself to her to the best of his ability. Not only did they celebrate single parenthood, but now they're celebrating same-sex parenthood, homosexual marriages, adopting children. changing the definition of family. And yet I go back to the Bible and I don't read an addendum to Genesis 2:24. A man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his husband. Or a woman shall leave her father and mother and cleave unto her wife. Or even in our modern society, the debate over transgender issues. It's not just a matter of these behaviors being wrong. It's a matter that these behaviors come from a humanistic point of view. I'm going to repeat myself from this weekend, so those guys who heard this before, if you want to tune out for 1 second or two, you can. All of these issues come from the mentality of it's all about me. This is what I want to do. This is how I identify. And you better get in line with that, or you're not being loving and compassionate to me. If I want to be called a woman, you got to call me a woman. If I want to be called a man, you call me a man. If I want to be known by one of these other pronouns of indeterminate gender, then that's what you've got to accept. Otherwise, I'm going to go to the government. And we're going to change the law. And we're going to make it illegal for you not to accept me for who I am. That's humanism run amok. The all about me mentality. I want to have relations and do the things that I want to do. And if a child comes of that, then I want to be able to abort that child. And there's nothing you can do to stop me. Because it's about me. We have gone from a cross-centered mentality to a self-centered mentality, and it is destroying us. I know that there are times when God allows divorce, but His design has always been that one man, one woman for life. And families picking up the pieces after divorce report the difficulties of trying to raise emotionally well-adjusted children. It can be done. We understand that. But we also know the best is God's design. The water is getting turned up on our families. And as humanism begins to promote its selfishness, we need to wake up before we are boiled alive. The economy. Okay, I know this is not about politics. We're not talking about politics. We're talking about how materialism affects our families. We're told in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 10, the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and have pierced themselves with many pangs. We are, Paul says, hurting ourselves when love of money replaces our love of God. Materialism begins in an atheistic naturalism. It supplants matter as God. Things become God. Not giving glory to the Father, it leads to the desire to accumulate the most things in this world. Matter is weighed, its value is weighed in the balance against other matter. This element is better than this element. Having this item is better than having that item. And yet Jesus clearly tells us in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 6 and verse 24, no man can serve two masters. He will either hate the one and love the other, or he will love the one and he'll deny the other. Man cannot serve God and money. It's impossible. And yet that's exactly what materialism tries to do. When John says in 1 John 2 and verse 15, the things that are of the world that we're not to love, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, he says, these are not from God. These are enemies of God. And yet those are the very things that slogans like more money or show me the money or greed is good or who wants to be a millionaire, they all play on the worldview that materialism trumps theism. We understand greed. We see it all around us. But materialism comes in a more innocuous way, too. One that we don't normally think of. Notice how the green movement, that's not just in America, it's worldwide, has developed into a global concern. Think about it. From Captain Planet all the way to the point of the climate change crowd that we see around us today. The ideas have become accepted as fact. We've got to save the planet. I walked into my hotel room. Right there on the bed was the save the planet card. If you're going to be here multiple days, don't make us wash your towel every day, because we're going to save the planet. Over and over, save the planet. You would think that it's just unknowable that we're going to save the planet. Yet climate scientists are divided about whether or not we're actually making that much of a difference to our planet. And the vast majority of them say that we're not a concern in the equation. But we don't hear that. We hear the politicians whoever can control this debate controls the money of the debate. We're hearing from the activists who feel compelled to voice their opinions to the media outlets, who knows that it's making headlines. But how should we as Christians, how does that affect us? Well, obviously we need to be good stewards of the resources that God has given to us. But we also need to trust God. There's another song we used to sing with our kids a lot. He's got the whole world in His hands. You know what we mean by that song? We mean that God is sustaining the world. And it will not be destroyed one second before God is ready to destroy it. And there's not one second we can add to the life of the world when God decides to destroy it. No amount of saving your towels and drying off with them for a third week in a row is going to stop that. The Bible tells us, by the same word, the heavens and the earth that now exist, in the context of 1 Peter 3, in verse 5, he tells us that there was the Word of creation. John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God, and that Word created all things. Peter says that Word that created all things is the same Word that the heaven and the earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. I don't think that first and second grade teachers, and that when they teach their children to recycle or their classrooms, they tell them, let's be green and be friendly to the earth and things like that. I don't think that they mean for this to be an atheistic philosophy. But let me tell you, the whole green movement is born of a denial that God exists and that only we have the power to save this planet. See, that's small incremental changes, isn't it? It was years before I realized that saving all my plastics and separating my papers was really from an atheistic point of view. I'm a man who believes in God. Why would I do those things? Well, I guess part of it is I don't want to live my own filth, you know. But at the same time, I have to understand I'm not saving the planet. God is saving the planet. And He will save it as long as He desires, and He'll destroy it the moment He desires. And nothing I can do can change that. But the green movement has infiltrated our common philosophy, hasn't it? What about our policies? Relativism. That idea that there's no absolute truth on earth. How much of our public policy arises from relativism? Things like, it might be true for you, but that's not the way I feel. You may feel that, but that's not right for this group of people over here. Or don't ask and don't tell. Let's take from the haves and give to the have-nots. You know, it's not right that the haves have so much, so let's give to those that don't have very much. The philosophy of abortion on demand, it may not be right for you, but it's right for me. We're going to do it this way. Legalizing drugs, drinking and driving laws, gender identity issues. I know to Christians it sounds silly. Years ago, I knew a young lady, she was 3 years old. I've known her from that time to now. She's 21, 22. But she's not a she anymore. She called me up and she told me that She's changed her name, that she doesn't identify as a girl anymore. And she wanted to know what the Bible has to say about what she's going through. And I said, look, I can't tell you don't feel the way that you feel. We live in that fallen world where disease and more material things and carnality preys upon our feelings and our desires. I can't tell you you don't feel the way that you feel. But I can tell you that everyone in the world, when they come to Christ, are asked to give up their feelings for Christ. The alcoholic who feels that he's got to have one more drink has got to give that up for Christ. The homosexual who feels that he's got to have one last liaison has to give that up to come to Christ. The promiscuous man who wants just one more opportunity to be with someone else has to give that up. Everyone who comes to Christ has to give up the way that we feel, because the way we feel has been challenged and changed and molded by a society that does not know God. And I said, as you start presenting yourself as a male, even though you are obviously female, you're presenting yourself in a lie. And if you want to be right with Christ, you've got to give up that lie. It's not easy. It's not easy for any of us that have addictions that we have to give up. But give them up we must. Every one of these ideas are based and the idea that absolute truth does not exist, even though Jesus would say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Many, even in the church, are starting to sell the truth and buy into these lies. Solomon would say, buy the truth and sell it not. We as Christians, we've held the truth and we've given it up at times when we know that we shouldn't have. God's word still offers truth on these subjects. What about our theology? You would think this would be the one place where we wouldn't have to worry about the infiltration of atheism into our philosophies. Theology, the study of God Himself, this shouldn't change at all. And yet, if everything is relative, then everyone's ideas are good. And that means that there's a multiplicity, a plurality of ideas out there that are good. Pluralism rules the day, that all opinions are as good as any other. To me, one of the scariest ones is the lie that says Islam is a religion of peace. You hear that from politicians and from people that don't really know Islam that well. You hear that a lot from them, and yet as soon as we hear it, we get this sense that that's not quite right. Where we don't hear that from are the advocates of that theology. The advocates of Islam are not telling us, it's just an Islam of peace, don't worry, we're not really out to kill you. We don't have a lot of them telling us that. Other people will, but they won't. In America, school children are called upon to practice Islam as cultural assignments. Our culture goes out of its way to cater to Muslims to prove that we are not prejudiced and that we accept every religion as good and as wholesome as others. If you go on a national scale and you start to criticize Islam, the first answer is, well, what about the Christian Crusades? Which are wholly misunderstood and mischaracterized, but they equate the two as if they're one and the same. And yet, we know they're not. How quickly do we forget Jesus' words that I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me. He who does not enter into the sheepfold by the door and climbs in another way, the same as a thief and a robber. Jesus is telling us there is a way. There is one way, and it is morally superior than all others. And it's not as if, you know, we follow His way or we follow a different way. We can almost get there, but just sneak in the door. No, Jesus says there is a way and no one gets there but this way. I know that sounds very exclusive. That sounds hardcore and unloving to so many people. But here's the thing. Anyone can walk that way. And that's why we have to tell people about that way. We can't buy into these atheistic philosophies and say, well, you know, there's a lot of people feel this way. I don't want to upset their apple cart. Let's go this way. It's sad. We can't do that. A year or so ago, one of the Robertson women from the Duck Dynasty TV show, maybe some of you have seen that. They've grown in fame and fallen and grown. You know, fame is one of those fickle things. But she was in an interview and she admitted that she'd had an abortion late in life. In the interview, she openly regretted her decision, citing the emotional heartache that she felt of having terminated that life, and the guilt that she felt every single day because of her decision. But she told the interviewer she wouldn't put her beliefs on others. And when asked if she considered herself pro-choice, she said, and I quote, "Yes, I'm pro-choice. I'm not going to put my beliefs on you. If that's the way you feel, then that's your choice. In the end, you have to speak to God about it, and so will I." Our society has made it a greater sin to speak the truth about God. They have made that truth a worse sin than actually killing a child. Do you see how we have warped our understanding of God? I feel for her and the heartache that she feels. If I could take the pain and the guilt and the agony away from the decision she made, I would gladly take it away from her. But to say that my beliefs are mine and you may do whatever you want is to sidestep what God has called us to actually do. The secularism of our current culture threatens not only our way of life, but more importantly, it changes our biblical worldview. Slowly but surely, the dangerous isms born of atheism are threatening to supplant our reliance on God for our salvation. As our secular culture reduces God to a footnote in history and blares to us humanism and secularism and materialism and naturalism, pluralism, relativism, and many other philosophies that are contrary to God, the day has come upon us that it's difficult to remain true to God, and all the much more need for us to stand firm. The water's getting hot. Hey, we're frogs in the pot, and the water is getting hot. When we peer in, it's not the frogs we see. We see ourselves. We see ourselves being bloated with carnal-mindedness and having never realized that the temperature was rising. In order to save ourselves, to save our children, to save our churches, to follow God, we must put away these worldly biased philosophies that attack God. Cast off those shackles and embrace God. Draw closer to Him, and He will draw closer to you. It's the same answer to save our country, to save our culture. Righteousness exalts a nation. Are you tired of looking in the pot and seeing yourself seasoned with a cup of carnality and a pinch of postmodernism? Today can be the day that Jesus rescues you from the stew. Today is the day that He gives you eternal life. No longer do you have to be quiet while the world crumbles or while your worldview is attacked. Today is the day you can become whole, because the Creator will recreate you in the image of His Son. This morning, if you're ready to come home to Him, His arm is extended, pleading with you. Believe in Jesus Christ as the way. realizing you can't pull yourself up by your own bootstraps, that you must rely upon Him, trust in Jesus who alone can save. Repenting of your sins, turning away from the old way, and embracing that new way, that new life of love and righteousness in Him. Confess Him before men and be baptized for the remission of your sins this morning. All things are ready for you. God wants you to respond. If you'll come during His invitation while we stand and sing, He will save you.